Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, I feel your pain in Chicago. You can all rip on me because I had to leave my Cafe Gallery open mic in Chicago because I was moving to Austin, Texas, because jobs were being stripped from us in Chicago. Yes, you can rip on us for that. But a polar storm came through. And it has been below zero for days and days and days, and we have been without power for, this is day three, without any power whatsoever. Joy. So, you know, we're rushing to Home Depot to get the last bag of charcoal so that we can boil water and I can have some warm tea to try to warm up right now. I swear it's insane. So, but I figured I'm going to have a mug. I might as well have my U of I one for you guys in Illinois. And the warmth is heaven. You know it. Yeah, I'm sure you do know, but you probably have power and heat in your homes right now. I know you guys understand cold, but alas, I wanted to give another bonus thank you to everyone. And ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to this bonus reading for the cafe and the cafe gallery. I will read on Tuesdays or Wednesdays, starting at 7 o'clock, because I would often read things from Scarce Publications books. So, what I thought I would do, I don't know, should I read with these glasses? Should I read with these glasses? I think these are fun. It's funny because there's a poet here who ran open mic pre-pandemic at Half Price Books, and he would always have these reading glasses, and these aren't mine either, but I would always go trying them on. How do these look? How do these look? And I keep them at the bridge of my nose because I can't see through them as easily like that or anything, but I thought I would try to read the last three poems from the Scarce Publications Down in the Dirt September to December 2020 book that is titled Perfect for This Time of Year, Late Frost. Trust me, it's unbearably cold out and shipping the ice off of my car. In fact, I have a license plate that says CHI for Chicago Poet. And I just looked at my car and there were all these icicles hanging down and I just photographed it. So if I get power back, maybe by next week after the Australian Open is done, which I'm not even be able to see right now, which is driving me nuts, I might replace my Facebook profile picture with the cover picture with a shy poet in icicles, because that seems way too appropriate. So I thought I'd share with you three poems right at the end of this book. They are from the Spartacus section of a December 2020 Down the Dirt issue, and they all relate to Christmas or the end of the year. So I will start with this first one that's called Usual Conquest Style, and it was written on the 24th for the 1777 date. The Kiribati, wait, is it Kiribati? Why am I putting on my sunglasses to read? There's like 7-point tiny type. Can I see it? Kiritimati, a.k.a. Christmas Island. It's really... But it was written because of the discovery of this island on the 24th. Titled Christmas Island, it's called Usual Conquest Style. There were many stories, rumors even, about where Christmas came from. Whether it sprouts from the lore or myth will continue to confound cultures. Information even circulates about Christmas Island, where it is and what is the meaning, which is when the world continues to confuse, because today, on Christmas Eve, British explorer James Cook discovered Christmas Island. Now, this is a Polynesian island, possibly one of the stopping points for ships that were traveling across the Pacific in the early 1800s, until trading died down and this raised coral atoll was later abandoned, even though the Republic of Kiribati, the nation in the Pacific Ocean, called this island a respelling of a Latin script for Christmas. For our usual conquest style, both Britain and America claimed this island, though we didn't do much with it. That is, until we realized that it was a good point for munitions discovered by World War I, and especially in World War II. But the real payload for Western countries came in 1957, 1957, when Britain and the United States could both test nuclear warfare, because the first thing we think of when it comes to an island name for something we're supposed to care about, something about giving and loving and others, giving and loving one another, well, this is our small island to plot out our own final solution of the human problem. So, this twice-abandoned Christmas island was eventually almost decimated, you know, thanks to Western expansion. And although the population is growing again, it is still only less than 10,000, despite its now protected status, all while suffering along the equator in a surprisingly dry zone, making fresh water a rarity unless during El Niño season, which is probably not what you pictured for Christmas Island. But then again, it doesn't matter the season or the holiday when it comes to Western civilization's penchant for destruction and annihilation. Those feelings don't need a season, for it seems some will always find a reason. That was a thing that was written on Christmas Eve for The Discovery of Christmas Island. And I've got one more about Christmas stuff here, about a Christmas island written on Christmas Day, titled Exploit the Island. No, it's not the same island. Get a load of that. This was written on 1225, Christmas Day, the date that Christmas Island was actually discovered. You guys ready? It's called Exploit the Island. I remember this Depeche Mode instrumental song. It's titled Christmas Island. And unlike a mellow or somber tune, it belted out some loud processional music with a strong beat that was almost an instrumental call to action. This song wasn't on their album, so it's only a tune that diehard fans back in the day would know of or even like. But the Christmas Island song that's in my head right now is the one by Bing Crosby and the Andrews Sisters. Sure, the Andrews Sisters didn't originally sing it with him, but I know Bing's crooning with Christmas songs, where this little ditty sings of spending Christmas across the sea, coconuts on the trees, and presents coming in on a canoe. And sure, Bing may have released this in the 50s, well after the original, but looking back, it confuses me when the only Christmas island I know of off the top of my head is a tiny place in the Pacific that was destroyed twice, then used for nuclear testing sites. So really, it doesn't sound like much of a true vacation retreat. But the thing is, the Christmas island I know was discovered on Christmas Eve by the British, which kind of seems like a weird reason to call it Christmas Island. And then I discovered that there is another Christmas Island discovered on Christmas Day by a European in 1643. So maybe this is a tropical resort Bing crooned about. Now, this Christmas Island discovered on Christmas Eve by Britain is a small island in the Pacific Ocean, while the Christmas Island discovered on Christmas Day by Europeans is a small island in the Indian Ocean. But after that, they both start to sound similar. Both islands are populated by only a few thousand people, and both were explored for annexation until countries came to exploit the island for their military. For this island, it first came with the Japanese in World War II. This tiny island then became a harbor for refugees, which had very few beaches and so little climate change at the southern edge of the equator, equatorial region. So, in some ways, this Christmas island was a beautiful place for people who needed to escape an unjust war, with the rainforests and animals differentiated from what you could find at the Galapagos Islands along the equator. But their only real resource was phosphate mining, when the phosphate was extracted from guano, which is the accumulation of excrement of seabirds and bats. And who said nature didn't work so well with mankind? So, no, this Christmas, oh no, this Chinese slash Malaysian slash Australian island, now under Australia's rule, which doesn't please the locals, may not be the Bing Crosby vacation getaway, but during war, Christmas Island was a paradise for those truly in need. I'm going to share one more with you. And it's funny because a subscriber or a person who has things published in Down in the Dirt magazine saw this poem in the book, which is titled Kiribati. And he's like, I had to read it because I've been to Kiribati. And it's this tiny little island and a stepping stone for traveling. It's odd to be able to say that I've been to Kiribati. And I was like, I've never been there. But, you know, I'm glad that I found somebody that actually could talk about their experiences at Kiribati because they read this tiny little poem. This was written on New Year's Eve, 1231. The 31st of December is called Kiribati. The beginning of a history webpage article reads, in effect, if you tell me that you were born in Kiribati on December 31st in 1994, then you are firstly a liar, and secondly, you do not exist. Because of the change in time zones, the previously called Gilbert Islands, these Kiribati Islands, were divided up by the international date line, and the western portion was 24 hours ahead of its eastern side. So, in effect, there were only 4 days in a week where businesses could even be conducted. This article explains that to correct this, the dateline was shunted to the east so that all the islands were on the same day. But to do this, the island had to skip the entire last day in December to pull this off. I'm always wondering what I should be doing on New Year's Eve. But what if, on one year, there was no New Year's Eve? What then? Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, I hope you guys are staying warm. Because as I said, it's been 3 days that we haven't had power. We heard that we might be getting it this afternoon. And when I was upstairs before I got an additional hat and coat to put on for this reading, flicker, and we had left one lamp on so that in case, and I see that I'm like, oh, we've got power. We could start heating this house. And 15 seconds later, it went out. I think everybody has kept their major appliances and their freezers and refrigerators plugged in, and there was such a surge of everybody needing so much power that within less than half a minute, all the power just died again. So, this is the end of day three. For us, with no power. I hope you guys are staying warm wherever you are. If you'd like to know anything about Scars Publications books, this one is for a issue collection book for Down in the Dirt magazine, the second magazine from Scars Publications. The first magazine is CC&D magazine that was founded in June of 1993. In 1994, there were a couple issues of CC&D that had a Down in the Dirt supplement of a couple poems, and then we started Down in the Dirt up in 2000 just because it sounded like a cool title, and because I love reading poetry and sharing poetry with the world in so many ways. So we started that up in 2000, and this is an issue collection book from Down in the Dirt, and so incredibly appropriate that when titles of books like these are named after accepted writings within them, that I choose Late Frost for the cover of this one, when there's just ice everywhere here, even in Austin, Texas. I hope everybody in Chicago, in Austin, and around the world is staying warm right now. I hope everyone is staying safe and staying creatively inclined, and I'm going to have another sip of my tea. Good. good at times. And if I want everyone to know that if they're feeling lost because things are really getting difficult right now, I want everyone to know that we have to keep telling this to ourselves. Things are going to get better. They are. You know, one day the power might come back. It'll happen, I swear. I hear that it's going to. They're trying. They're really trying here in Austin. But know that you're not alone. Know that things are going to get better. Stay strong. I'll put on my sunglasses so I can look the part. I have no idea what the part is, you guys. But there you have it. I hope everybody enjoys reading. If you want to know anything about Down in the Dirt magazine or CC&D magazine, they're through Scars Publications online at scars, S-C-A-R-S .tv, /CCD for CC&D magazine or /dirt for Down in the Dirt. You can find anything about these magazines. If you would like to submit any writing, you are more than welcome to, and there are ways to find email addresses to send submissions. And once again, thank you all so very much for listening. Stay warm, stay safe, stay creatively inclined, and I will speak to each and every one of you very, very soon. Thank you very much. Thank you. Can't forget the tea. Thanks.